lattice with anisotropic exchange interaction, and we'll especially use a three spin term that breaks time reversal symmetry. And this problem has a connection to different other subjects. So for example, it has connection with the toric code. So I'll mention that. But it also has connection to topological chiral superconductors or superfluids, in which it's known that vortices carry non-abelian anions. It also has connection to merging transition of Dirac points, which were studied in the anisotropic graphene or graphene under stress. And it has also connection to topological insulator, and specifically to the Haldane model of a Chern insulator. So I'll mention those different connections. So the main message and the outline of my talk is the following. I'll first have a long review of Kitaev's model, where the main point is to explain that the Hilbert space separates in different blocks that are uncoupled, which are called vortex sectors. And then, after this long part, I'll review also the 16-fold way, which is another result of Kitaev. It's contained in the same initial paper, but it's somehow more general than just related to the Kitaev-Honeycomb model. And then I will show you, that's the third part where it's really work we are doing these days with Julien. It's in this third part that I will show you that within the Kitaev model, it's possible to access all these 16 phases. Actually, it's ongoing work, so I'm hoping for the future. Actually, we only found 15 for the moment. So the the Kitaev model is a model on the honeycomb lattice with a spin a half on each vertex, and you have an anisotropic interaction like this, where you have Ising term on each link, but the involved Pauli matrices depend on the link type. So you have links which are labeled X, those that are labeled Y, and those that are labeled Z. And in principle, you can play with three different exchange interaction on the three different links. After a while, I will restrict to the isotropic case. And first, I only consider this term, and later on, you will see a three-spin term playing a role. So an important property of this model is that for each plaquette, hexagonal plaquette, there is a conserved quantity, which is the product of these six spin operators. You can show by hand that this is commuting with the Hamiltonian for every plaquette, which means that the Hilbert space separates in uncoupled sector, in which in each sector you give the value of the eigenvalue of this operator, this small wp, which takes value either plus one or minus one. And from now on, and by definition, I will call a vortex a plaquette such that this operator has an eigenvalue minus one. And a vortex sector is a pattern where for each plaquette I say whether I have a vortex or no vortex, only two solutions. And this means that the initial Hilbert space made of a spin n spin a half with this size splits into this number of vortex sector. And now in each vortex sector, this is the size of the remaining Hilbert space. So the way Kitaev solved this model was by mapping this spin problem into a problem of Majorana fermions hopping on the honeycomb lattice and in the presence of a static Z2 gauge field. So I want to quickly review that. So the gauge field is the quantity called U. It lives on the links. It's anti-symmetric, and its value is plus or minus one. And there is a convention for the orientation. So the usual convention is that you have even and odd side, black and white, and the U34, it takes a positive value in the usual choice when you go from black to white. And now, so these are the gauge degree of freedom. And you also have Majorana fermions here. So those are real fermionic operator. And Hamiltonian written in spin language, it translates into this Hamiltonian written in Majorana fermions. And the conservation of the WP, it translates into now conservation of this quantity. So the U's, they are commuting with the Hamiltonian, so they are conserved. You can treat these guys as being numbers. And so the only remaining operators are the Majorana operator, CJ and CK. And so here, I forgot nearest neighbor. The Hamiltonian is just a tight binding Hamiltonian where the hopping amplitude is all this quantity. Associated with the Z2 gauge field, you can define a magnetic field or a flux. In every plaquette, the flux is just the product of these guys around a hexagon, and it's either plus one or minus one. When it's plus one, no flux, and when it's minus one, it's pi flux or a vortex. So now the problem is much simpler than before because we obtain a quadratic Hamiltonian. It's non-interacting Majorana fermion, so you can solve this problem exactly. And because it's a problem written in the language of Majorana fermions, it means that actually the matrix here that you would want to diagonalize, it has a doubled spectrum. So every eigenvalue comes in plus and minus. And there are as many eigenvalues, or if I only count the positive one, as plaquettes, not as sites. So another thing which is known about this problem is that so for each vortex sector, for each pattern of vortex in the lattice, you need to solve one of these tight binding problem. And they are more or less easy to solve. They are all just single particle problems to be solved, but some of them you can do analytically if you have a translational invariance because you have a simple pattern, but you can have a random pattern or a complicated pattern, in which case you have to solve a matrix which has the size n times n, where n is the number of sites. So it's known that the ground state is in the vortex-free sector. So let me just count the Hilbert space dimension, because in this mapping from spins to Majorana fermions, you are enlarging the Hilbert space. So the initial problem has this size of Hilbert space, but when you come to the Majorana representation, actually the way Kitaev does it is that first he replaces every spin operator by four Majoranas. On site J, it's called C, Bx, By, Bz. So it's four real fermions, or it's two complex fermions per site. So now the size of this enlarged Hilbert space is 2^2n. So because you have a four complex fermionic mode per site, so 4^n. So now you can also see it another way. With these three, actually you make the links operator, they are hidden inside the U's. And now you keep the C, so you have one Majorana fermion per site, and then you have one U per link. So there are n sites and 3n/2 links. And so that's this same counting, but separated into the Majorana part and the gauge part. And you see that the degrees of freedom, which are surnumerous, which are too many, are the degrees of freedom related to gauge freedom. Because now, if instead of counting gauge freedom or gauge field, you count the magnetic flux, which is measurable, now you have still n Majorana fermions, but you have as many magnetic fluxes as plaquettes, n/2. And it's taking two values, plus or minus one, so that's again 2^(n/2). So that's the magnetic field, that's the Majorana fermions, and that's the gauge field. And as I mentioned, the great simplification is that once you realize you have to deal with quadratic Hamiltonian in Majoranas, instead of solving a problem with many particles, you solve a single particle tight binding problem, and that's just an n^n matrix. So you go from an exponentially large Hilbert space to a linear size in number of sites. Okay, so an important thing which took some time to be realized after Kitaev's work is that there is something subtle in the projection from the enlarged Hilbert space to the real Hilbert space. And this has to do with the fact that the initial problem actually conserves not the number of complex fermions or the matter fermions, but it conserves their parity. So the parity of the number of complex fermions is actually fixed. When you are in a given sector, in a given flux pattern, with a given geometry of your system, if you're in a finite system on a torus, for example, and with a certain value of the parameters in the Hamiltonian, then if you want to your Majorana problem to represent your spin problem, you have a given parity in complex fermions. So you, among all the levels you find, you should only keep those that have either even or odd parity, but not both of them. And this is changing things. If you want, for example, to compute the degeneracy of the ground state and to find whether it's 3 or 4 because you are in an abelian or non-abelian sector, this matters a lot. If you don't do this study of the parity of the number of fermions, usually you go wrong. So these people that have understood this clearly, they check that by comparing the Majorana solution to an exact diagonalization directly on the spin system. So you can check if you're correct. And with Julien, we made some progress on that. We haven't finished, but basically, we see that what really matters in terms of parameters is the parity of the churn number of the corresponding band structure for the fermions. That's what decides the correct parity. Okay, I just want to pause here to mention that there are 3 alternative viewpoints on the Kitaev model. I mentioned the original problem in the language of spin, then the transform problem in the language of non-interacting Majoranas in the presence of a static Z2 gauge field, in which case the spectrum is doubled in the sense that to every positive energy state you get a negative one. And it has a conserved fermion parity, here fermion meaning the complex fermions, not the Majoranas. But there is a third language which is also interesting and valuable, which I will not talk about here. It's another way of solving this initial problem by doing a Jordan-Wigner transformation to a problem of complex fermions, but with a Bogoliubov-Degen Hamiltonian for P-wave chiral superconductors. This is also an interesting mapping, and it shows the same feature of having a double spectrum and a conserved fermion parity. So it's not, there is no well-defined number of fermions, but there is a well-defined parity. Okay, so what's the phase diagram of the model? So that's the phase diagram of the model just with the exchange, the anisotropic exchange. So it depends on the value of Jx, Jy, and Jz, and you probably all have seen this triangular phase diagram. There are basically 2 phases. When you're close to isotropic coupling, you have a gapless phase. And when you are close to very anisotropic, one of the exchange is much larger than the other two, then you are in a gapped phase. So in these 2 phases, the emerging excitations are interesting. They are of 2 types, either complex fermions or vortices. So in the B phase, which is labeled gapless, it means that the fermions are gapless. So you get something like Dirac cones, plus the vortex, which always exists as excitation and which are always gapped. And when you are in the anisotropic phase, you get Dirac cones, but which are gapped or massive Dirac particles. Those are the gapped fermions, and you still get the gapped vortices. And actually, the problem is very close to the problem of graphene. So this is a problem I studied in the context of graphene many years ago. It's the same problem of fermions hopping on the honeycomb lattice, and you play with the different hopping amplitude. Here, they are called T instead of J. And what is known in this context is that if one of the hopping amplitude among the 3 is very different from the other 2. If it's much larger, then the 2 Dirac cones, so they appear like 6, but there are actually only 2 in equivalent at the corners of the Brillouin zone. These 2 Dirac cones, they come close together. At some point, they fuse, and then a gap opens. When they merge, there is an interesting dispersion relation which is half linear and half parabolic. It remains parabolic in the approach direction, but it's linear in the perpendicular direction. So those are called semi-Dirac fermions. There are now a lot of people studying this kind of system because there are experimental realization of this type of dispersion. So I mentioned this is basically the. Sorry?
This special point when a 2D rack
touches. Yes?
I understand, this is not protected by any type of symmetry.
No, it's very fragile. Okay. So it's fine tuned. But people are studying the. So there have been, in the context of graphene, there have been a lot of studies on the effect of Coulomb interaction and even short range interaction on the stability of Dirac cones. And the fact that, for example, Coulomb interaction, it modifies the shape of the Dirac cone, which becomes logarithmically with a higher velocity. But this guy has a different behavior in the presence of Coulomb interaction. So with certain interaction, you can open a gap from here. And with other interaction, you go back to a situation with two separated Dirac cones. So that's the fermionic excitation. They look either like nodal points if you're close to the isotropic case, B phase, or they look like this. They are gapped if you're in the A phase. But I mentioned that on top of fermionic excitation, you also have vortex excitation. So the vortex excitation in the A phase, they are known to behave as abelian anions because the model actually maps to the toric code. So actually, I give you my hand-waving view of this phase. The type of excitation you have in this phase are the following. You can think of them as being some charge flux composite. So the flux is modulo 2 pi because it's a phase. But the charge is modulo 2 because that's what's conserved in the model, only fermion parity. So the vacuum, you can say it's no charge and no flux. No flux is 0 or 2 pi. Then you can make an excitation which is a pure vortex. A pure vortex is a pi flux. It's a WP equal minus 1, and it has no charge. And then you could say, OK, I have no excitation, a vortex excitation, and then I have the fermionic excitation, which is the excitation which is a charge 1 and no flux. But then you realize that once you have those three, actually you can combine number 2 and this one to produce another type of vortex, because if you combine a fermion with a pure vortex, you obtain a vortex with a charge. So now actually you have two types of vortices. And this is indeed the kind of anions you expect for the toric code. So vacuum, two types of vortices, and the fermion excitation. And actually with this little model, you can understand the mutual statistics and even the exchange statistics of identical particles. OK, so now I switch on an extra term, which is a three-spin term. So I go back to the spin problem. I take the isotropic point, so I'm in the phase which is gapless. And now I try to gap this phase. And I introduce this three-spin term, which was actually introduced by Kitaev as a perturbative Hamiltonian obtained from actually coupling the real spins to a real magnetic field, and treated this in a third-order perturbation theory. So those are magnetic field in the x direction, y direction, z direction. And you see it has the structure of third-order perturbation theory. But that's only the historical way. For us, this is a term present in the Hamiltonian, and we won't assume that the coefficient kappa is small. We'll take any value for kappa. So this three-spin term, it has some orientation. So you have to pay attention to the order of the three-spin term. And the other thing you can notice is that because there are, sorry? So the term in the Hamiltonian with the magnetic field, it's H vector dot Pauli matrices, or Pauli, or vector of Pauli matrices.
But it has nothing to do with the dimension that
No. And you can notice that this term has three spin operators. So if you apply a time reversal transformation, each spin gets a minus sign. So you have an odd number of spin operators, you get a minus sign. So this term breaks time reversal symmetry. So now I look at what this term does in the equivalent problem of Majorana fermions in the presence of a static Z2 gauge field. You obtain, this is the term we had before with the three J's equal, the links plus or minus one. And you notice that there is an I actually. So this is a nearest neighbor hopping term. And you see it's a nearest neighbor hopping term, but which has a direction and which carries a phase pi over 2. So nearest neighbor, it carries, I need to put an arrow to say if it's EI plus pi over 2 or E minus I pi over 2. But you see that as long as you only have nearest neighbor, it doesn't really matter that you actually put this phase or do not put, because when you go around a plaquette with the conventional orientation of the links U, you actually produce no flux inside the plaquette, because each time you have an arrow in this direction, you have an opposite one here. So that's zero flux. And now we have this new term, and this new term, this three spin term, you can actually show that it produces two Majorana fermions hopping term, but it's not nearest neighbor, it's a next nearest neighbor. So it's a jump from white to white or from black to black. It also carries an arrow, and it also carries a flux plus or minus pi over 2. So not yet a flux, but it carries a phase plus or minus pi over 2. And actually, this is a picture taken. You've noticed that I'm very bad at drawing. I only grab pictures in other papers. So that's a picture from Kitaev paper. That's a picture from Haldane's paper. It's actually almost the same model. The context is completely different. But this one is in the context of having electrons hopping on the honeycomb lattice and having next nearest neighbor hopping with an inhomogeneous magnetic field inside every unit cell. But the total flux threading a hexagonal plaquette is zero. So it means that in this picture, you have a positive magnetic flux in the center here. But everywhere in the AB region here, it's negative magnetic flux. So that the total flux, if you only make around the hexagon, it's zero. But now if you hop like this, then you capture some positive flux. Or if you hop like this, then you capture some negative flux. So this model introduced by Haldane was a way to generalize the quantum Hall effect, but without having Landau levels. So it's a way of breaking time reversal symmetry, but without killing the translational invariance of the Hamiltonian, because this guy, he still has a band structure. And actually, this model is exactly the same, except that it's for hopping of Majorana fermions instead of complex fermions, and that the phases that appear only take one value. It's plus or minus pi over 2. So every jump here is plus or minus pi over 2. In the Haldane model, you have a knob, which is the amount of phase you capture on the second nearest neighbor hopping. And also in the Haldane model, in principle, you can put a different onside energy on the A and B side. It's called M. So here we take M equals 0. We put phi equal pi over 2. We replace the Majoranas by electrons. And that's the Haldane model. Another difference is that on top of all that, you remember that we have the vortex sector story. So we have a pattern of vortices. This is not contained in the Haldane model. So now I just want to, because I got confused at first with all these fluxes, so I want to summarize for you. There are three types of vortices or fluxes in the problem. There is a single vortex excitation. I told you, by definition, is having a WP equal minus 1 in a plaquette or having a pi flux. Actually, those excitations, they only come in pairs. And how do you see that they come in pair? You take the initial standard gauge in which the U's, they go from black to white. And then this cancels over a hexagonal plaquette. And you just flip one of the arrow, when you flip one of the arrow, you realize you have a minus one here, but you also have a minus one in the next placket. And if you flip again, then you move. But the vortices, they always come by pair. So for me, this is one type of thing, one type of object. It's a single vortex excitation. Now, we also get a vortex sector. So a vortex sector, it's a pattern on the whole of your system, a pattern of vortices. So white is zero flux, and dark is pi flux. So to solve the whole Kitaev problem, you need to solve your Majorana problem for every vortex pattern, whether periodic, non-periodic, having many fluxes, only a few fluxes. You need to solve all of these. And now, because of the three spin term, kappa being different from zero, we have a third type of magnetic field, if you want, in the problem, is the fact that now, once you have a second nearest neighbor, you not only have zero and pi flux, you start to have plus or minus pi over two fluxes. Because now, if you make this type of loop, you can get plus or minus pi over two. If you make this kind of triangular loop, you also can get this plus or minus pi over two. So this term, it introduces no total flux inside the placket. It only introduces inhomogeneity inside the hexagon.
So the Uij define the vortex sector?
Actually, the Uij, they define the three things.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So now you also have Uij between next nearest neighbors?
Yeah, I went a bit. Yeah, you get two of these guys. So to find what you put here, you need the Uij here and the Uij here. Yeah.
Okay, so the nearest neighbor, they are the same as before.
Yes.
And you have new ones.
Yes.
Diagonals, and these can also be plus or minus.
Yes. Okay, but soon there will be a force magnetic field. So. So now I grab the result from Haldane's model, which is well known. So that's the on-site staggered energy that I'm not playing with. This is breaking inversion symmetry in the honeycomb lattice. This direction is the phi flux. So it's the phase on the nearest neighbor hopping. So this one is fixed in the Kitaev to be pi over 2. So you're here. And I'm m equals 0, so I'm right there. I'm in the phase which is labeled churn equal plus 1. If I flip the sign of kappa, so I flip the sign of the nearest neighbor hopping, I can be here in minus one. So the Haldane model was really important in showing that you can get the Landau level type of physics, meaning having churn numbers, but in a band theory. So here we have a band theory for Majorana fermions, and therefore we can also define the churn number. From the Haldane model, that's what's happening to the fermions. They become gapped, so you get gapped nodal fermions, gapped Dirac fermions. The gap is proportional to kappa, to the next nearest neighbor hopping amplitude. And if you make a finite geometry of this with edges, so here I do infinite ribbon with two edges, and you can compute the spectrum, you get the bulk bands, and you also get chiral edge modes. So you have a chiral edge mode on here and another chirality on the other edge, which is related to having a non-zero churn number in the bulk. So now we'll have the same type of physics, but not for electron, but for Majorana type of fermions. So with Julien, we like to play with a Hofstadter butterfly. So we have several ways to compute churn numbers. So here is maybe an original one. One way to compute the churn number for the Haldane model is actually to add a homogeneous magnetic field on the whole plane and to add, so now it's a force magnetic field. You add an extra magnetic field and you plot the energy spectrum of a single particle hopping in this Haldane problem and you obtain the energy spectrum. So here you have the bulk on the torus in blue, the bulk levels, and the levels for open boundary condition in green. You see that they are on top of each other, except in bulk gaps, which are now filled with edge states. And actually, from studying what happens close to zero applied magnetic field, we can, so here you see it's gapped near half filling. in here by studying how the number of states below this gap, which is this number of states below a gap, how it evolves with the applied magnetic field, you can compute the Chern number. This is the celebrated Streda formula for the quantum Hall effect. But here we use it just as a technical tool to compute the Chern number. Here I did it for the Haldane model, that's the Haldane butterfly, but you can do the same for any vortex pattern. Here I did it for the vortex-free sector. So I also want to make connection between the Haldane model and the Kitaev model in this tenfold classification of topological insulator and superconductors. So we are in 2D, and here you have 10 symmetry classes. So the simplest symmetry class is this one with no time reversal symmetry, no particle hole symmetry, and no sublattice symmetry, no chiral symmetry. And this Z is the Chern number for the quantum Hall effect, or the anomalous quantum Hall effect, or the Chern insulator. So that's the Haldane problem. And now the problem we're looking at with the Majorana fermion is actually this class, and it's this Z. It's also 2D, has no time reversal symmetry, but that's the double spectrum with the plus one, so it's this class. So here again, it's also a Chern number taking Z value. So the Z, it counts actually, it's a property of the bulk, but it counts the number of chiral edge states. So here, because the problem is that of Majorana fermions and not electrons, it's actually chiral Majorana edge modes, so they do not carry charge. So they do not produce a quantum Hall effect, but they produce a thermal transport, where the coefficient here, the central charge, is related to the Chern number in the bulk. So now I want to summarize what is known about the Kitaev model in the presence of kappa when kappa is assumed to be small, which is the case if it comes because of a Zeeman effect. Yes?
So, as I understand, what you are doing here is that you are looking at the Chern numbers characterized coming from the Majorana fermions.
Yes.
And you get edge states. If you go back to the original Snell language, what do these edge states correspond to there?
Actually, I don't know. I mean, to me, this is very surprising. It's the magic of emergence. You have a spin problem, and the excitation in the bulk are already surprising. There are fermions, spinless fermions, and vortices. And now you put a finite geometry with edges, and because of the property of the band structure of these bulk emerging fermions, you get a chiral edge state of these fermions. Yeah. So I think they are really there. I mean, if you could have a...
No,
I don't... But I don't... I don't have a clear picture of what these chiral edge modes would be in the language of spin, if that's the question. Yeah. Some things you can work back, but some are very hard, because if it's simple in the language of fermions, it's still a Slater determinant, and then you need to translate back to spins. So it's not always easy to do. So what was known in the literature was the vortex-free phase near the isotropic point. It's gapped and it has a Chern number 1. This was found by Kitaev, and he analyzed the excitation in this phase and found that the vortices, they actually behave as non-abelian anions, easing anions. Then there was a study of the vortex full case, the case where you put a vortex pattern which is still translationally invariant, but you have a vortex everywhere. So in this case, the Chern number is minus 2 or plus 2, depending on the sign of kappa. And then more recently, there has been studied of extra vortex sector, periodic, but built on triangular vortex lattices. And what has been found by these people is that in this case, you have an emergence of a Chern number, but which are always even. So 0, minus 2, minus 4. So now I come to the 16-fold way. So the 16-fold way is also a contribution of Kitaev, who understood that once you characterize the fermionic band structure by Chern number, you can also wonder whether this Chern number has an influence on the properties of the vortex excitation. And what he found is that the exchange statistics of the vortices depend on the Chern number modulo 16. So the first thing is that there is already a property that depends on the Chern number modulo 2, which is whether the vortex carries an unpaired Majorana zero mode or not. So the hand-waving argument is the following. Why is there a difference between those two cases? So the hand-waving argument is the following, is that you go by what you know from the quantum Hall effect. So you take two copies of Kitaev model with nu equal 1, which is more or less two copies of a topological superconductor with Chern number 1. And because you have two copies of things which are basically half electron, you obtain a quantum Hall effect with nu equal 1. I mentioned that the edge states in the case of the Kitaev model, they are chiral real edge states, whereas here it's chiral complex edge states. So once you have a quantum Hall effect with nu equal 1, because you took two copies of Kitaev model with nu equal 1, it means that if you insert a pi flux in your double layer system, because of the quantum Hall effect, inserting a pi flux, it will attract or bind a charge 1 over 2. And the interpretation of having half-integer charges, this was done by Jacques-Yves and Rebi. It's the interpretation is how you do that. It's because you have a zero energy electron level that is either empty, minus one-half charge, or filled, in which case you have a plus one-half charge. So now we have a quantum Hall effect, and we have a zero mode because it corresponds to having nu equal 1. And now you separate your two layers, and you say that the two layers are completely equivalent. So it means that you have half an electronic zero mode in each layer. And half an electronic zero mode, it's basically what an unpaired Majorana zero mode is. Otherwise, if you are, this is very hand-waving. If you're not convinced by this argument, it's known for many years, actually, that this happens. The oldest reference I could find is actually of work, again, of Jacques-Yves and Rossi, who showed this unpaired Majorana mode in a relativistic version of this problem. Yes?
You mentioned that we can also solve the problem using Jordan Beam approximation.
Yes.
And in that case, we have proper complex
fermions. Yes.
And I guess the same thing, I mean, also exwolves appear there.
Yes.
So
same solution.
Right.
Or yeah, equivalent solution. I can't really tell you more. I didn't read very deeply this work of Chen and Nusinov. But so that's a first property of the single vortex that depends on the Chern number mod 2. Then actually, if you ask not only about the presence or absence of an unpaired Majorana zero energy mode inside the vortex, you can ask about taking two of these vortices and trying two equivalent vortices, trying to exchange them and see what's their exchange statistics. So you, to do this, you again take two copies of a Kitaev model with a given Chern number, and you say that this is equivalent to having a single quantum Hall state with new Chern number, in which case you insert a pi flux, and you see that this time you attract a charge which is nu over 2. And now you have this charge flux composite, so made of a pi flux and a charge nu over 2. And you compute the Aronoff-Bohm phase when you take one of these guys and make a double exchange, a full loop. You obtain this Aronoff-Bohm phase. Then you expect that the exchange phase is half of that. And then you argue that actually you separate the two layers and you should have half of this phase for the half object, and which gives you this type of exchange phase. And now you see the exchange phase is 2 pi nu divided by 16, and therefore it takes different value, only 16 different values. So the complete 16-fold classification of vortices in this system is much more complete. it actually shows that there are indeed 16 classes, but that they separate in different type of anions. So either you have odd nu and you obtain non-abelian easing anions. So those are the cases where the vortices, which are called sigma, they carry an unpaired Majorana mode inside. And you have two other family when nu is even, in which case you obtain abelian anions. So I mentioned the toric code case, nu equals zero in the A phase. I mentioned the fact that in this case, you have two type of vortices because you have a vortex pi flux which is uncharged, and you have a vortex which is charged. So this has zero pi, and this one is one pi. And then you have another version of that with also two different vortices called A and A bar, in which case they are both things carrying pi flux, but one of them has a charge a half, and the other one has a charge minus a half. So basically, 16-fold way is 16 exchange statistics or anion theory for vortices inside such a KIT-IF model, or more generally a topological superconductor characterized by a Chern number nu. So now, how am I? No, I'm still okay on time. So now I start the part which is work that we are doing with Julien. Basically, we're doing something very simple. We play with a vortex pattern. Here it's one which is a triangle lattice with one vortex every three plaquette, and we look at the gap from the ground state to as a function of this kappa parameter that breaks time reversal symmetry. We compute the gap and we compute the Chern number. So here the numbers are the Chern numbers. Here it's squeezed because there are two very small phases here. And for example, here you see that you only have even numbers.
This is for finite parity boundary condition?
Yes.
How many sites?
Yeah, but when we checked it, we also checked the nu on the torus. But in principle, we believe it's the result for the thermodynamic limit, because when it's a pattern like this, one third, it means actually you need a unit cell like this, but then you have a translation invariant, so you can solve exactly, yeah, in the thermodynamic limit.
If you think of kappa as being created by an external magnetic field of some sort,
yeah, this. Yeah, here. Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of people actually only looked at small kappa for the reason you mentioned, and didn't look too much into different vortex sector because they think the ground state is in the vortex free sector.
And what's the next term in magnetic field? It's kappa magnetic field to.
Yeah, actually, already at the same order, there is another term which is a 4. A Majorana fermion interaction term, which KIT-IF swept under the rug. And already at lowest order, when you have a real magnetic field, the WPs, they are no longer conserved quantities. Yeah, so we are really playing with a model. I don't think that it represents the real KIT-IF model in a magnetic field. So now I just want to show you this type of graph for other vortex sectors. And you will see the main message is that there is a lot of variety.
Yeah, just one stupid remark, but if you look at what happens at very small kappa, we are at the isotropic point, and for kappa equals zero, you can see that the system is gapped already, which is not the case in vortex free sectors studied by KIT-IF. And since it's gapped, when you switch on kappa, you are still left with a zero Chern number at very small.
I should have shown you the slides because I have one on this topic. But thank you for spoiling. So it's this one. So even at the isotropic point, we said it's in the B phase when kappa equals zero. So it's supposed to be gapless. But if you have a vortex pattern which has this property, that 1 over the vortex density is 0 mod 3, and this was studied in a paper with Julien and co-workers, you already get a gap even at kappa very small, actually zero. It's gapped this time by the vortex lattice itself. Actually, the vortex lattice is coupling the, you remember there are two Dirac cones, it's the same band structure as graphene, it's coupling the two Dirac cones and it's gapping it without breaking time reversal symmetry. That's why the Chern number is known to be zero for sure there. So here you get two examples of that. Still only a billion or even number Chern numbers. So this is another interesting case which was studied but at small value of kappa. If you go to larger values of kappa, you have a gap closing and you have a transition, direct transition between two very different Chern numbers. So here you expect a lot of chiral edge modes if you have a finite system.
Just again a question about this additional Uij which are not between nearest neighbors.
So
it's clear that the values they should take to find the ground state in a given vortex lattice.
No, that's one
question.
So this has been assumed for many years in the literature, and I don't think it's correct. So once you have the kappa term, I don't think the ground state is in the vortex-free sector.
Okay. So the data you are showing?
We fix a sector. We only answer questions about this sector.
But you show the vorticity on hexagon. It doesn't completely specify how it's distributed inside each
hexagon. No, it does, because there are not new use. It's the value you put here, it depends on what's here and here. But it's completely specified. Yeah. Okay. Now we also looked at, for example, 1/4 and 1/9. It has the property that it's 1/d², where d is an integer, and this was studied in this work of Latinen, Ludwig, Pachos, and Trebst. It's a paper about a nucleation of topological quantum liquids starting from vortices. And what they noticed is that you can only obtain even Chern numbers. So here we do two examples, and indeed, even playing with kappa, we only get, but you see, we start getting large numbers. But now, if you play with a more complicated vortex pattern, you do get odd values. So for example, in this pattern, we get 3, which was not known, -1, which was known. Here, I don't remember what's the value. I didn't put it. And here, for this vortex pattern, I don't have the gap picture. But I know that for kappa, in between those two values, we get a -5. We also find this in this zoology, we also find this interesting case, which is the contrary. This case, you put kappa to finite value, but it doesn't gap. It remains gapless until a very large value for kappa. So I don't know what's this phase, actually. I don't know. That's why we are working on this issue of fermion parity. Because if you want to answer this kind of question, you want to answer the ground state degeneracy in the original spin model, then you have to know what's the correct fermion parity to take and not take every fermion parity, in which case you... So I can't tell you I didn't do it.
You have the Majorana bond structure.
Yes. I guess I don't remember how it looks like. You remember what it looks like?
When it's gapless, you can have the answer of the integration of the degeneracy, but when the system is gapped, if you have an even Chern number, the degeneracy will be 4.
Okay. My question is whether you have flat modes in this case.
But it's more than flat, the system is completely
like
gapless.
Pagomelite.
Nobody means a flat band. So what we know is that, so I don't know what's the dispersion relation. You're thinking of the twisted bilayer stuff, in which case they obtain flat bands.
I mean, the gray hexagons is like a Kakomelite, is Kakomelite wondering whether the gap of future is related to perhaps, I don't know.
You want to know whether there is a flat band or not in the spectrum of this system?
Yes, yeah. I don't remember what's the shape of the band structure there. Okay, so I think I'm almost done. It's Friday afternoon. You're probably happy if it's shorter than planned. So my conclusion and perspective. So the main message is that if you start playing with vortex sectors, you can obtain much more variety than initially thought in the Kitaev model. And we didn't find all values mod 16, but almost. Actually, there's only one missing. Nu equals 7, if I remember correctly. You also get a variety of gap behavior as a function of kappa. Sometimes the gap is already present when kappa is 0. Sometimes the gap does not open even when kappa is finite. Sometimes the gap increases with kappa. Sometimes it saturates at large kappa. Sometimes it drops to 0. Yeah, I mentioned the fact that we are working also on this projection on physical states, and it seems to matter for some quantities. We would like to study also the behavior of these non-abelian phases beyond the vortex-free case in the vortex-free sector, in which maybe there is something interesting. We'd like also to study the nature of this gapless phase at finite kappa. Of course, another interesting question is to even go out of the realm of periodic vortex sector. You can start playing with random vortex sector, but probably this is quite a demanding study if you need to average. There has been some work in this direction in this paper. And yeah, this I mentioned, where actually once you get a finite kappa and you break time reversal symmetry, it's no longer completely obvious that the ground state is in the vortex-free sector. Okay, I think I'm done. Thank you.
So you say you're missing 7?
Yes.
Should that just be the time reverse partner of 9 or something?
Yeah, but we're missing 9 as well. No, actually, once we get one sign, I know how to get the other one. But so it probably just means we didn't play with enough vortex patterns. No, not yet. It's just that I think the argument that it should be there doesn't work. Yes. No, I haven't found a counterexample yet.
But what are the relative energies of these different vortex sectors that should give you some intuition about?
Yeah.
Certain patterns of vortexes will increase or decrease.
So each time you add a vortex, you pay a vortex excitation that are gapped. Therefore, when you add vortices, at first you think you're losing because it costs energy. You add more vortex, it costs more energy. But then those vortices, they interact. Yeah. So they can, they bind, they can lower the energy. And then the vortex pattern modifies the fermionic sector. So you can gain energy in the fermionic sector as well. So I mean, we haven't done a detailed study, but to me, it's not completely obvious that it should be in the vortex-free sector. Actually, and Julien mentioned that to me many times, historically, Kitaev didn't know about the Leib theorem that the ground state should be in the vortex-free sector, and he performed numerical calculation on several vortex patterns to realize that vortex-free is slightly below, but it was not by much. And this was a study at kappa equals 0, without the time reversal breaking term, only the isotropic exchange.
So all the chain numbers you showed were computed using this Streda.
No, actually, we use three different methods to compute Chern number, so it was a way to check, but it's not the most efficient one. So in the end, I think the most efficient is either the original Kitaev method or the Fukui numerical method. Yeah. We do it by say the problem is that sometimes the results seem to be to get the thermodynamic limit value of the Chern number. It's not always easy because it depends on the grid you put in K space. So we do periodic lattice, we have band structure, but then the Chern number, when it's a large value, it means you have many bands. We need to sum over many bands and many K points. If we take a too large grid, sometimes you get a wrong value. So yeah, we checked it by different methods.
Yeah, just a short comment about the conclusion. So with the Schroeder method, the main advantage is that you always get an integer.
By construction.
Might not be the correct one.
Yeah, here actually what we do is that we take the value at zero magnetic field, apply the magnetic field, and then we put one extra flux tube. So the denominator is one by construction, and the numerator is the number of states below the gap. So it's also, so it's an integer divided by one. So by construction, it's an integer. It's by which amount the number, when you insert one quanta of flux, by which number of state the number below the gap changes. This gives you this.
In a large system, it's a tiny shift.
Oh yeah, it's where everything happens
here.
Yeah.
Only when you have a crossing.
Yeah, yeah. So I showed the whole butterfly, but everything happens here. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.